what they just had in terms of moisture in the area
could
certainly happen again.
Scott Sharp is leading this race. As you know, he did not pit last time. They had a yellow. He's going to have to come in somewhere about 28 or 30 laps from now, and he'll certainly be hoping for some form of a yellow to slow the race pace down, so when he gets his service run, he's not going to lose too much time on the racetrack.
Two on fuel, please.
You heard them tell Scott Sharp that he is pulling away and doing so steadily from second place. Elio Castroneves now with an 0.8 of a second lead.
Paul, this is a team that had more than its share of problems during the warm-ups, practice, and everything leading up to this race. Scott Sharp's crew was draining fuel out of their car when a flash fire occurred, and a couple of their crew members, including Robert Perez, suffered some second and third degree burns on their hands. Thankfully, it was none of the crew members that go over the wall. Everybody is okay, but sometimes out of bad fortune, good fortune turns itself around. Seems to be the case thus far for Sharp.
Allenser Jr. has dropped back to seventh place. You see him there. And behind him, there is a large group all battling for position. Jr., Anthony Lazaro, Eddie Cheever Jr., Jacques Lazier, who contact with Thomas Schechter. Yellow comes out. Wow. It got so crowded back there. Scott Goodyear, as you said, it gets so very busy here. But again, in Jacques Lazier, we're talking a veteran, but he's gotten together with a guy who said this track is tricky and is brand new to the track, Thomas Schechter.
Certainly looked like Schechter was trying to get underneath Lazier going into three. We talked about before, turn three is the best place to pass. It's the only part of the racetrack where you've been traveling down the straightaway for a period of time where you can actually set somebody up, get a little bit of a draft, and get underneath them going into turn three. Now, Thomas looked like he was on his way past Lazier, didn't get the job done. Both guys wanted to get right to the middle of the track at the same time, and they both touched and collided, and this is the end result. Watch here, Thomas going on the inside, already on the curving, comes on the underneath side of Lazier. They touch and off they go. Both Lazier brothers have not had a very good luck here today, I'll tell you. Now watch this, Schechter on the inside, trying to take advantage, a little bit of traffic, trying to get underneath Lazier. Both of them don't have enough room. Lazier running a little bit of a higher line, trying to come down and do a later apex. Now watch as they come towards the turn. You'll see the two lines that they're headed for. Looks like Schechter's already about ready to make his pass. Lazier is running a wider line, about ready to pick up the apex right down here in this section. And as we continue along, you'll see that he's gonna push himself up onto the curbs, has no room to move. His right front touches the left rear of Lazier and off they go.
Now we'll take a look at onboard shot. Boy, that's heavy damage on both of those cars. That's going to be expensive.
Heavy damage, Paul, especially since Indianapolis is coming up here very shortly. Two well-financed teams, though, that do have spare cars sitting back there in the shop, ready to get ready for the testing starting here in a couple of weeks. We're on board with Jacques Lazier. You can see that he was just driving along. You did not see Schechter's car come into frame, so Lazier probably didn't see him. Schechter's trying to get underneath him, trying to get a run towards turn three. Schechter is probably at fault in that situation. Probably should have just waited another lap to set up Lazier going down the backstretch.
And safety team spending a little extra time at Thomas Schechter's car. And we'll keep track of that, of course, for you and report as soon as we have some information. Let's also point out that for Eddie Cheever, the owner of that car right there, it's been a very expensive year. He's had one heavy hit. And for Thomas Schechter, it's his third DNF in four races this year. Jackaroot, what are they saying in the pits?
Well, Paul, earlier in the drivers' meeting, Brian Barnhart sat down every single driver in this field and went over that specific scenario, the one that we just saw unfold between Thomas Schechter, the rookie, and Jacques Lazier. And he explained it thusly. He said, guys, if you are side by side, the man on the outside has the advantage, the man on the inside must back out. He actually talked them through what would happen, Scott Goodyear, even though you are side by side going into the corner because of the apexing of these corners and how difficult it is. A very costly rookie mistake by Thomas Schechter, but you must hold harmless Jacques Lazier.
A very tight track, as we talked about. Schechter obviously trying to move up with his teammate. You saw Eddie just in front of him. But certainly he's trying to come back from where he was, running around eighth or ninth, trying to move forward in the pack, getting ready for the next pit stop.
Pits will open next time by behind the Chevrolet Corvette
pit.
Pace car.
We're going to pit. We're going to try to go the distance and win the race. Go ahead and pit.
And that's what
I'm going to tell you. Pits are open. Coming in right now.
Scott Sharp will be in. It's been 85 laps since his last stop. It looked to me, though, when I was watching the replay with Scott there, that Thomas Schechter got in there so quick and Lazier came across that Schechter didn't really know what to do about how to get back out of that situation.
We were watching that just a few laps before. It looked like Schechter had a bit more speed,
here we
a little
go,
bit
Scotty,
more momentum.
Here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, right here.
Now let's watch this
okay,
pit stop for Scott
Sharp. Hold it.
And you heard, fellas, as he was called in, Tom Kelly said, let's try to go to the distance now, make no more pit stops, and most importantly, win the race.
And we're waiting for word from medical because both Jacques Lazier and Thomas Schechter still in the car, safety team working with both of them. So Elio Castroneves, with that stop by Scott Sharp, picks up the lead of the race under yellow. So it'll be a little while before we get back to green flag racing at Nazareth.
This Wide World of Sports update brought to you by ExxonMobil and SpeedPass, today's way to pay. Here now, Bob Jenkins.
136 laps complete under caution because of an incident involving Thomas Schechter and Jacques Lazier. Both are out of their cars. They were placed on stretchers, taken to an ambulance. We'll hopefully have an update on them in a few minutes. Let's give you more medical updates now. We heard from Robbie Buell a little bit earlier in the telecast. He is setting out this race. Sarah Fisher is substituting for him. Robbie voluntarily passed up the race because he says he wants to be 100% for the Indianapolis 500. Eliseo Salazar is also not here this weekend. Richie Hearn substituting for him. Eliseo was involved in a crash at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway testing last week. Now, he sustained an injury that required some surgery. They had to break the sternum and do some heart surgery to repair a situation, and so he is out for, doctors say, 6 months. Eliseo says he hopes to be back racing by the end of the year. And all of us are hoping for a speedy recovery for NASCAR Winston Cup car owner Jack Roush, who was involved in a private plane crash a couple of days ago in Alabama. The last report was that he is responding to doctor's commands. It's a big open wheel weekend here in Nazareth. USAC races were held earlier today. The USAC Midget Series saw Michael Lewis take the lead from Dave Darlin on lap 15 and go on to win that 25 lapper. And then the USAC Sprint Car Series competed, and Tracy Hines led all 25 laps, beating A.J. Fike and Jay Drake. Back with more in just a moment from Nazareth Speedway. Elio Castroneves leads Jill DeFerrin. And the cleanup continuing from the crash involving Jacques Lazier and Thomas Schechter. We hopefully will be going back to green in just a moment. Both drivers, when placed on the stretcher, by the way, did wave to the crowd. So hopefully their injuries are not serious. But it has been a very action-packed race here this afternoon, from crashes and from a little bit of moisture that has been falling from the skies. But right now the skies are cloudy, but not too bad, and we hope the rain will hold off. So let's go back and take a look at what has happened in the first few laps of this race. It all started out on lap number 38 when two of the IRL's best, Sam Hornish and Buddy Lazier, touched wheels, and that sent Lazier hard into the outside wall. Hornish was spending 48 laps in the pits, and Hornish is now running in 22nd position. Then on lap 54, Rick Treadway coming to the green spins. Lap number 90, Sarah Fisher touches wheels with Anthony Lazzaro. And John Herb on the same lap also has contact with the outside wall. Then most recently on lap number 122, it was Jacques Lazier and Thomas Schechter. At the end of the backstretch, they touch wheels also both hard into the outside wall. And again, we are awaiting an update on the medical condition of both drivers. They were placed on stretchers and will be checked over at the infield medical facility. So that is the situation as it stands down to Gary Gerrard.
In the Penske pits with Tim Cindric, the president, who is on the radio with Elio Castroneves. What's the strategy? How do you play it here with weather concerns and still just under 100 laps to go?
Yeah, at this point in time, obviously, you're watching the weather all the time, and you're sitting there thinking you've got one more stop to go to the end. There's three or four guys that came in before us. Hopefully, if it comes to that and they make it to the end, we're strong enough to pass them on the racetrack.
What's the biggest concern, Tim?
Just a matter of when to come in and get our last stop done and what the weather's going to do.
Okay, they keep an eye on the sky. Let's go to Jack.
Well, Gary, Alex Barron is having a whale of a ride for Larry Blair and his new sponsor, Rayovac Batteries. Tom Gloy calls the shots here. When you talk to Alex, who has run at Nazareth before, Tom, did you guys come up with a conservative strategy to race here?
No, it's not really conservative. It's just that Alex has a lot of knowledge. John Dick, our engineer, has a tremendous amount of knowledge. So we're really running very, very hard. We've been really good in traffic, even though it's difficult to pass here. So it's a great weekend for Blair Racing and for Rayovac Batteries.
Now, the most important thing, though, is you do have to make one more stop. Is that correct?
Yeah, there's only one guy that doesn't have to make another stop, and that's Scott Sharp. So we need to make sure we don't have so many yellows.
I tell you the kind of comedian, Bob, that this guy is. I says, when are you going to stop next? He says, oh, Tuesday.
A veteran of various types of motorsports, glad to have him in the IRL. There is Elio Castroneves, who is leading this race. And again, at the beginning of the program, we set up the tail of the tape, the battle between Team Penske and Pennzoil Panther and Sam Hornish. However, Hornish, because of the accident, is not involved in today's battle. In the 2002 IRL season, Team Penske with one win, Sam Hornish with two, but it's very close.
Back at Nazareth, Pennsylvania, the Firestone Indy 225 getting ready to come back to the green flag. Castroneves will lead him back, his teammate at Marlboro Team Penske, Jill DeFerrin in second place. Great story with Alex Barron coming back. You see him there, the white car, in third place when they come back for the green flag. Interesting development, though, Scott Goodyear. Felipe Giafone, driving for Morris Nunn, came in and stopped just about five laps ago. That should carry him all the way to the end, and even though it put him back in the field down to 13th position, he is certainly capable of racing with the leaders. He's proven that today.
He has been running strong. He pitted at this yellow opportunity when the race pace is slow, probably going underneath the same strategy they have for Scott Sharp's car, and that's to bring him in and hopefully only have one more stop. And they had their stop, so they're basically leader with no stops for the remainder of the race, much like Scott Sharp is now. And Penske, a lot of the guys up front, probably are still looking at one more stop.
You've got a couple of different strategies at play here. From Castroneves back to ninth place, Ayrton Dare, all of those cars have about 20, 25 laps before they have to stop. And then comes a group that's led by Scott Sharp that probably has as many as 58, 59 laps before he has to stop. And then, of course, Philippe Giafone. Green flag comes out. Back racing at Nazareth. Barron and Ward both close in.
A great run off of turn two, slips on the inside of Barron at turn three. Barron tries him again down the front, just a case of momentum.
Now Ward looking for Jill DeFerrin, second place, half a second ahead. There's the leader, Elio Castroneves. But remember, what's happening here and now is extraordinarily dependent on pit strategy to the end of the race. There are cars like Giafone back in 13th. Whoa! Trouble, that's an engine. And it's an engine on Jeff Ward's car. Yellow comes out. They're a little bit worried about oil on the track. Wow, after that great move.
Well, they always say the engines run best just before they blow up. And boy, he certainly looked like he was going to be a threat.
Here comes Jeff Ward, the engine already gone there. Alex Barron, boy, he's in a world of hurt trying to figure out where he's going to go. And thankfully, he didn't get into any oil that may have come back from that engine.
Two things happen with that, Paul. Number one is vision. The smoke's coming up in front of you. You're trying to find your place on the racetrack. And when you see that, you know the engine is gone, and you certainly hope that no fluid is on the racetrack, which will make you slide off into the wall.
Well, and speaking of Jeff Ward, who climbs out, still staying in the car. Remember, he's a great Supercross champion, and if you love Supercross, watch the gang, including Ricky Carmichael, who's just been awesome this year, because it's Supercross coming up next on ABC Sports from Texas Stadium. EA Sports Supercross next here on ABC. So now, how will the strategy play? Jeff Ward climbs out of the car. Down in Alex Barron's pit, they're thinking, let's bring this car in. Only 55 laps since his last stop, but this, of course, would give him a run to the finish.
But Paul, in this scenario, what Alex Barron and his team, the Rayovac team, have decided is it's going to be monkey see, monkey do. If the leaders stay out, if Marlboro Team Penske stays out, Tom Gloy has instructed Alex Barron to stay out likewise.
Well, if you look down the pit road, the Penske team does have a couple of guys over the wall, and they kick the tires back in. They're not going to go. Hornish is on the pit road, though. Now remember, Hornish running well back at 21st is also 49 laps behind the leader. Almost makes you wonder why they run the car. The points position, and now they don't for a second there, then they got it going.
What's that feel when you get a chance, Sam?
Any points will certainly help at the end of the year. If they can pick up a couple here, they're really in jeopardy of doing that, but any points will help in the championship fight, that is for sure.
Paul, I think the one thing that we've all got to start to look at is what is the magic number for the first three cars in terms of when they must pit. What we are hearing mumbled around down here is about lap 170 to 175 or so. That's an optimum situation. Let's check in with Harry.
Coming to a stop, the Corteco car, number 7, Al Unser Jr. He led early. They're having problems getting the fueling nozzle engaged. Now, finally, it locks in. But that cost them about 4, maybe 5 seconds. It's a short fill, and he's out. I'm not sure they got very much fuel in there, guys.
Well, they would have to get a fairly tall load in that car if they want to go to the finish. So tires must be their issue. Green flag. Because he did not come in, Alex Barron remains in third place behind Jill DeFerrin and the leader, Elio Castroneves. Eddie Cheever Jr. in the Red Bull car comes up now to challenge Barron. He looks to the inside, decides no, and loses a little momentum doing that. Now he comes back at him. That's Anthony Lazzaro behind Cheever, and then Billy Boat.
Right now, it looks like Cheever has a little bit more speed than Barron. Thought better of trying to get down the inside of him on turn three, much like we saw the crash with his teammate just a few laps ago.
But the Southern Californian Alex Barron is holding his own. This has been a wonderful opportunity for him driving for Larry Blair this year. Now picking up the new sponsor in Rayovac. He's one of those drivers that for a number of years you've said, keep an eye. This may be his opportunity.
Doing outstanding job. If you look now, We're starting to catch up to the two cars in front, Castroneves and DeFerrin. Maybe in a couple of laps, if I have an opportunity, start working on DeFerrin himself.
The front four running close together. There they are, all on the backstretch. Allanser Jr. now in danger of going a lap down because of his stop, late stop under the yellow. Just got a glimpse of him. There's a pretty good separation now from the front four back to pit lane. Jr. just ahead of the leader, Elio Castroneves. Cheever looks at Barron.
He's still there. Right behind you now.
Well, now, three would have been Castroneves' best turn to try to make a move on Unser Jr., and he didn't take the opportunity. DeFerrin's now taking the opportunity to close from second.
DeFerrin, a very smart race car driver. Very quiet, very thoughtful, very methodical. Probably sitting back here waiting for Castroneves to get close to traffic. If he can take the opportunity to get him in traffic, I'm sure he'll do that.
DeFerrin right there, back of DeFerrin. Castroneves, when DeFerrin and Castroneves joined the Penske team, started referring to DeFerrin as the professor, because of his vast knowledge and all the help that he has been to Elio Castroneves. There comes Anthony Lazzaro, fifth place. He's now beginning to run that front running group down. And there's Billy Boat as well behind Lazzaro.
And Paul, Anthony Lazzaro has a new status, a new tactician calling the shots here. This weekend, his regular engineer was called back home due to an illness, and it was only Sam Schmidt who was making all the calls. Sam joked about the opportunity and said, either I'm going to have to give a hefty raise to my engineer at the end of this race, or maybe I'll be able to save quite a bit of money. I wasn't quite sure where he was headed with that one.
DeFerrin moves up on Castroneves, left, right. Trying to carry that momentum off the corner.
Keep in mind that all four of these cars in the front, they still must pit one more time.
Repeat that, I didn't quite hear you. Got me on.
Jack Arute, when you're driving, who's your tactician? Your dad do that for you?
Yeah, now and again, it's more like, well, you did a good job, but.
Reminding us that our announcer is really Jackie Arute, and Jack Arute Sr. is the true Jack.
Now what's happening here at the front, guys, is that Allanser Jr. is getting the blue flag. That flag means move over for the cars behind. But Al Jr., I can assure you, is pedaling that car as fast as he can because he does not want to go down a lap. But he's about to right now.
Elio Castroneves gets past. The flag is kind of an insistent advisory. Now to Barron. Barron almost gets caught up there. You mentioned that before. You got to be so careful if you're the second car in the pass. That gave Lazzaro a chance to close down on Cheever. And now Boat's going to try to work Lazzaro. Whoa, whoa, whoa. He puts Dare very high. Dare saves it.
And that was a great save. He could get off the gas and spun that thing around, but he just did a nice job.
The 34 car, the Mijack car, is Loren Radon. He's not in this battle. He's down behind the leaders, currently running in 15th, four laps behind the lead. Here comes Sarah. Sarah tried to make a move. Now Cheever trying to work on Allanser Jr.
Art and Dare, when something like that happens, you got to clear your head, get back on the gas, and get your pace back.
Sarah Fisher, despite that problem that she had just before John Herb's yellow, has stayed on the lead lap. Currently sits in ninth.
We just saw a moment ago, Allanser Jr. in front with Eddie Cheever behind. Eddie Cheever shaking his fist to Allanser Jr., trying to get some notice to him in the mirrors. He's trying to also put him down a lap so he can get back up and catch up with the leaders.
And you can see anytime he gets a little straight area, Al's looking over to the left mirror. I think he's just trying to figure out, where can I place the car?
Cheever with that infinity power, a good run going down here to three. Will he make it on the inside?
No.
Very close. You got to get a good strong run off of turn two. You heard there on the radio, the spotter for Allinger Jr.'s car telling him, let Cheever go.
No way.
And there's Al's response, no way.
Yellow comes out, brush with the wall. A lot of parts, and it tells us it's off of the 31 car, and that's George Mack. Remember, he's
fine.
Wait,
you're all right, George.
Yep, he's
all
right.
Why in the hell Sam tried to pass him? He's only, what, 30 laps down?
George Mack got in trouble on the front stretch earlier in the race, spun it, didn't touch anything, was able to get back in the fight. And this time he puts the car up against the wall and brings out the caution. You heard his crew ask him if he's okay, said wave. If he is, he waves, so he evaluates himself as all right, but that bunches the front runners up again, and what will it do for stops? My best guess is that now Castroneves, DeFerrin, Barron, Cheever, and Lazaro, and Boat all will hit the pits.
We heard him actually having some conversation with his team, talking something about Sam, an altercation.
Well, that's not a great sign. We're still waiting for official word from medical, but that's the medical helicopter warming up. Remember, we have both Jacques Lazier and Thomas Schechter. Gary Gerald, what's their status with the hospital?
Oh, here the helicopter is lifting off, going right up over our head at this moment. Both of the drivers, Jacques Lanier and Thomas Schechter, are awake and alert. They're responding beautifully, we are told, by Dr. Henry Bach through his spokesperson here at the medical center. They are taking him to a local hospital for further x-ray and examination. But again, both alert and responsive, very encouraging news. And both men, again, are going to the local hospital, both being transported.
So the Red Bull sign is out for Eddie Cheever as the pits come open, and we expect at least the top six all to hit the pit road.
Playing into everybody's hands, another yellow, a track like this. Everybody up and down pit road was expecting something to come out and cause a yellow. They don't like to see cars crash or drivers injured, but I can assure you that all the teams up and down there are betting on another yellow so they can pit underneath a slow condition.
So Jill DeFerrin stays out. I assume because they're both 82 laps from their last stop that that's just an effort by Penske to make a clear run in and out for both their drivers.
Absolutely. We saw that Castroneves' left front tire guy ended up picking up the tire to allow Castroneves to come into the pit, and DeFerrin's left front tire guy picked up that tire to allow him to get in and have a clean shot going into the pit lane. On the next time around, I'm sure that you'll actually see DeFerrin come in and make his pit stop the next time through.
Alex Barron stopped, Anthony Lazaro stopped, Billy Boat stopped.
Three. 10-4, just make fuel here, make fuel. Stay out.
So Penske's gonna keep him out.
Therefore, I'm coming now.
Well, that's interesting. 83 laps since DeFerrin stopped. That's a long.